I'm so glad to be here, and so glad to be here this time with my shoes intact. I've got to tell you real quickly, I think the last time I was here, I had been somewhere else first on my way here and drove from there to the hotel next morning. Of course, I was dressed casually because it was a travel day. Next morning, I got dressed up in my suit, went to get my shoes, and realized I couldn't find them anywhere. And then realized the only shoes I even had with me were a pair of Crocs and a weird-looking pair of tennis shoes that had this squiggly design on them that I thought is really going to draw attention. I called my wife and I said, I am in a panic. I have no shoes. I think it's their friends and family day, and they're probably going to look at me and say, what is wrong with this guy? And I said, I've wore the Crocs. She said, no, not the Crocs, not the Crocs. So then I called Johnny and I said, he answered the phone. I said, what is your shoe size and how far do you live from the church building? And he said, I think he told me he was an 11. 11 and a half. I'm a 12. I was determined to be an 11 and a half that day. And so he met me. I said, you meet me in the parking lot, please, with a pair of shoes. Now, Johnny, as you know, or most of you here would know, played for the Giants. I'm a big Dodgers fan, and the Dodgers and the Giants don't always get along. But Johnny and I found a way past that, being brethren in Christ. But before he would give me the shoes, he said, you profess your love for the Giants. I said, right now I would profess my love for just about any nation in the world. Give me those shoes. And so I preached that day in 11 and a half shoes with 12 size feet. And the next day I went and bought me some shoes at the outlet and gave them back. I did fumigate them before I gave them back to him, but I was glad to borrow the shoes of a giant in a different way, and I appreciate him as a giant in the faith. So glad to be here with you. My wife is actually able to be here because fall break happened to fall at this time, and she has to go back Tuesday, but I'm thrilled that she could be a part of at least the first couple of days of this. Now, I'm a teacher at heart, so I want to begin with a pop quiz. I want to ask you some things. Are you 100% certain, and I mean with absolute 100% certainty, that God really did make this world? None of you were there to see it. I wasn't there to watch it happen. So since none of us actually saw it occur, why do you believe that with such certainty? Now I want to ask you this. Do you really believe there was an individual named Jesus of Nazareth who also was the Son of God, and that he actually did come from heaven? He actually lived upon this earth in the flesh as God in the flesh, and that he died as a perfect sacrifice and arose on the third day. Were you there to see him rise from the dead? How do you know for sure that he did? And moreover, you've heard that he left this earth and went back into heaven, and that he's coming back someday to raise the dead. Well, let me ask you a question. Do you believe without a shadow of a doubt that you will be raised from the dead? Do you believe that that's really going to happen to you? When you die, do you think you're going to rise from the dead or not? Yes or no? What do you believe about that? Well, have you ever seen a resurrection? And if you've never seen a resurrection, can you tell me how you are so sure you're going to be raised from the dead? And has anyone in this room ever been to heaven and actually seen it and come back to tell about it and brought the video to prove that, oh yes, it's real? How do you know that heaven is really up there? How do you know that hell is really a real place? I mean, where do you come up with these ideas and know them so certainly to be true? Well, I'm here to tell you this morning in the Bible class hour that I am not ashamed to believe in things I've never seen because of what I already have seen, and the explanation for the things I've already seen gives me absolute confidence to believe in things I've never seen. Now, when you go to Hebrews 11, I know that most folks understand immediately. When you mention Hebrews 11, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? The idea of faith, right? It's the Hall of Faith chapter. All these great men and women are there in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, and they were men and women of faith. But do you know that I preached from this chapter for many years with an emphasis that is a legitimate and needed emphasis? The faith that saves is the faith that obeys. There's no doubt about that. I'm not backing away from that one iota. But I think I missed for a few years another component to this. The first part of this, these individuals who obeyed had to do so believing in things they'd never seen. Let me illustrate, first of all, the definition of faith that is given in Hebrews 11:1. The Bible says, now faith is, it is what? The substance of things hoped for, or the assurance of things hoped for, and notice here, the evidence of things what? Not seen. And then he even mentions the first thing I mentioned to you, creation. He says in verse number 2, through faith we understand. We understand what? That the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And so, are you telling me, preacher, that you believe that God actually spoke this world into existence? I take Psalm 33:6 at its word. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of his mouth. Verse 9, for he spoke, it was done. He commanded, it stood fast. Just like that, God spoke this world into existence, and I know that this world exists, and I know that someone had to make it. The complexity and design of this building alone is sufficient proof to me that there had to be a builder. I mean, I look around and I see the different parts of the building that are seemingly intentionally built this way, with the air vents being so many inches or feet apart, and it's such regularity. These television screens behind me did not just jump up and fasten themselves to the wall, and there's a reason they're mounted here instead of in that back corner. And I can see all kinds of evidence of design in Hebrews, you know what Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 4 says? For every house is builded by some man. Well, who would deny that? But he that built all things is whom? It's God. Houses don't build themselves. Universes don't make themselves. There is, beyond the azure blue, a God concealed from human sight. And the Bible in Daniel 2:28 affirms there is a God in heaven. I know he's there, even though I've never seen him. I wasn't here when he made this world, but I know worlds don't make themselves. Someone with, and this is where the idea of causality and cause and effect and the cosmological argument come in. That's just a fancy way of saying that every effect must have an adequate cause. Picture back during the time when this building was actually being built. I don't know how long ago that would be now, but picture the time when this building was actually under construction. You're driving by one day, and you notice 2 3-year-olds out here with hammers going like this. How many people are going to drive by, witness that, and say, that must be the explanation for this building right there? You see those 2 3-year-olds? Now, if the building were torn down, maybe that might be the explanation, depending on the 3-year-olds. But you look at this and you say, okay, I know that 2 3-year-olds don't constitute an adequate explanation for this effect. Someone with intelligence and design beyond a 3-year-old have to be responsible for this. And this is the multiply that by infinity, and then you've come to the idea of the universe. Someone with such extreme power and wisdom and ability must have been involved. Even the circulatory system in your body and mine boggle the mind who did that? Who was able to take miles and miles of circulatory system and put them all in one body that's about 6 feet tall? It's amazing to see. Now, as you look at Hebrews 11, there's this emphasis of not seen that just keeps being threaded throughout it. I want you to notice that in verse 7, by faith Noah, being warned of God of... Have you ever noticed this next phrase? Being warned of God. What was Noah warned of God about? Of things what? Not seen as yet. Tell me, how many worldwide floods had there been prior to the time of Noah? How many? In fact, it's very, very possible there'd never even been a local flood. So, Noah, I'm going to ask you to build an ark because I'm going to bring a deluge that will destroy the world, and everyone not on the ark will die. Noah, you build that ark. I want it made out of gopher wood, this long, this broad, this high. Here are the animals I want you to bring on it. Now, I want to ask you, could Noah, after being told to build the ark, could Noah draw from an historical incident when someone had been told in the past to build an ark and that a worldwide flood was coming, and they built the ark and they made it? Therefore, I'm confident, based on history, that people have already been there and done that, I can do. Noah did something that men had never seen done. Built an ark to face something that had never yet come, a worldwide flood. And yet, why did he do it? By faith. He took God at his word. Faith is believing that God says it's going to happen, and then believing, yes, it's going to happen. And so Noah builds this ark to the saving of his house. Now look at verse 8. Here's Abraham. Abraham, I want you to go out to a place that you will afterwards receive for an inheritance. And he obeyed. And look at this last part. Look at this last part. He went out not knowing where he was going, not knowing whither he went. Abraham, do you know for sure that this is the way? Yes. No, I don't. I really don't. My wife and I love to celebrate our differences as they make us a couple. I don't know if we're the only couple in this room that has different aspects and approaches to things. I call her lovingly Patty Planner. She has to plan it out, know exactly what's coming. And if it's not mapped out to the final detail, she's not comfortable. She wants to get to the airport 2 hours ahead of time. I want to get there just in time to get through checkout and make it to the plane. I think her way safer, quite frankly, but I look at her and I see her differences in mind. She wants to know the future before it's even happened sometimes so that she can rest assured. Sometimes we don't have the liberty of knowing the future, though, do we? Someone says, I'd like to know exactly what's going to happen in this country after November 3rd. I'd like to know, too. I don't know everything about that, but here's what I do know. I do know there have been individuals in the past who have been called to do things and to go places that they were uncertain of, and yet they were able to make the journey looking to God every step of the way. And that is what Abraham did. Now put yourself in Abraham's sandals, and you're told at age 75, you and your wife are going to have a son, and he's going to be a son of promise. You're 75 years old at the time. 5 years go by, he's not here. 10 years, 15, 20, he's not here. 25 years approximately will go by before you're going to be 99, your wife's going to be about 90 when this is reconfirmed. Now, let me ask you a question. We're not talking about Abraham and Sarah living in the earlier part of the patriarchal age. How many folks in their 90s were having babies in Abraham and Sarah's day? How many? It wasn't something that was common by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, the Bible refers to the deadness of Sarah's womb. And Abraham was almost 100 years old. And so how can they believe they're really going to do? Abraham, do you know anyone your age? No, I don't. So what makes you think you're going to? I trust God. God told me this is going to happen. I take God at his word because everything he's already done proves he's capable of doing what man has never seen. So I'm going to trust God and believe in something I don't know about. Watch, if you will, please. The statement there is made, if you drop down to verse 17, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son. Put yourself back in Abraham's sandals. You were 75 when God said he's coming. You waited 25 years for him to get here. He finally got here, and then he's grown to a sufficient age that he's able to carry wood on his back and to carry the items necessary to make a sacrifice. And God says, Abraham, you know the son that I told you about that you'd have and that you had? Yes, I want you to take him into the land of Moriah, and I want you to offer him there as a burnt sacrifice. I'm sorry, what? If I do that at his age, when he has no child, no offspring, no marriage, no offspring to follow, God, if I kill him, there goes your seed promise. Do you know what Hebrews 11:19 said Abraham had calculated? And the word accounting here in the King James Version comes from a term that has to do with the idea of making the mental calculation. He accounted that, verse 19, God was able to raise him up. Question, how did Abraham know that God was able to raise up dead people? How many recorded resurrections from the dead do you read about in Genesis chapters 1 through 21? How many? You don't read of a single one. So it's not like Abraham could say, raise from the dead. Well, that's never happened. Oh yes, wait a minute. I did hear about that one time that happened over here. Abraham had no historical point of reference to say God can raise a man from the dead, but he did have this. If God is capable of making man out of the dust of the earth, and he did, then God is capable of taking a man who's died and raising him up from the dead. And so Abraham actually believed that God was going to raise Isaac from the dead. If it got that far, if God lets me go so far as to kill him, God's not going to fail to keep his promise, rather. He's going to raise him up so his promise will be kept. I know it. Even though I've never seen it, I believe it. I know it. So then watch his descendants. Here they come one by one. Isaac, Jacob. Verse 20, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau. What's the last phrase? Concerning things to come, things that had not yet been seen. Joseph, we're told in verse number 22, makes mention of the exodus of the children of Israel, and yet at the time Joseph makes mention of this, things are hunky-dory between Egypt and the children of Israel, and yet Joseph somehow knows there's going to be the need for an exodus from bondage when it hadn't even happened. He predicted something that had not yet been seen bondage-wise and exodus-wise. And Jacob, his father, had already seen things that would happen to his boys and gave predictions of that in Genesis 49. Then we come to Moses. Verse 23, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents. And then watch what he did. He made a conscious decision in verse 24 to refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And he esteemed the reproach of Christ as greater, something he'd never seen actual tangible riches of Christ that he could hold in his hands. And yet he esteemed that as greater than treasures in Egypt he had seen, and that he actually could have had a part in. And you see verse 27, do you know why he was able to do this? By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured, here we go, as seeing him who is invisible. Moses, do you trust in a God you've never seen or a Pharaoh you have seen? I trust in the God I've not yet seen. Why would you do that? Because I have seen what that God has already done. I've seen him make the formation of the world, the formation of a nation. I've seen his preservation of that nation. What I have seen gives me absolute confidence to trust in the things I've never seen. And so, yes, I believe. And then verse 28, picture this. Here they are, the 10th plague is about to hit. They're going to get out of Egyptian bondage. What's the plan? How are we going to escape from a military power like Egypt when we don't have military trained servants and soldiers? How are we going to pull this off anyway? Okay, here's the plan. We're going to have you, all of you, on the 10th day of this month, take an unblemished male lamb of the first year, and we're going to have you kill it in the evening and smear its blood on the two side posts and the upper door post of the house wherein you'll eat the Passover. And then when I see the blood, when I pass through Egypt that night, when I see the blood on the doorpost properly applied, I'll pass over every house that has that blood properly applied, and none of those firstborn will die. How many of the Israelites, upon hearing this battle plan, could look at each other and say, yep, you remember the last time we did that? When was the last time they had done this? When was the last time they'd ever done anything like this? They never had. So for them to believe this plan could work would mean they'd have to believe in something they'd never seen done. Did they believe God was going to do what he said he was going to do, yes or no? Mark it down, they did. And you'll notice here that in verse number 28, indeed, through faith they kept the Passover. Now they get out of Egypt, and things look to be going well until, whoa, the Egyptians are in hot pursuit, and the Red Sea stands between us and freedom, and the pursuing Egyptians. The waters will part, the ground will be dried, and we're talking, by the way, and I don't know why, but in my childhood, when I heard about these exiting Israelites, I pictured a band of maybe 175 or 100 folks taken off. By the time you put the numbers together in Exodus 12 and the book of Numbers chapter 1, you put it all together, you're talking about anywhere from 1.2 to 2 or 3 million Israelites, not counting their animals and beasts they were taking with them. Now, what kind of swath do you need to cut in a body of water for that many individuals to walk quickly across without having to? Can you imagine a single file line? You picture a narrow swath with narrow walls of water on each side. That'd be worse than the DMV ever could dream of being, right? But God is able to cut a swath of water wide enough for that many people to cross in organized fashion, in fairly rapid fashion. And so how do I know these walls of water that are standing there are not going to collapse when I get down in the midst of the Red Sea? How do I know that? Oh, don't you remember the last time this many people crossed the Red Sea and walls of water were standing? Everyone made it fine then. They did not have any historical moment to say, yep, when they did it, the same thing we've been asked to do, so we know it's going to work for us because of what they did. They didn't have a historical moment to draw from. And yet, sure enough, verse 29, by faith, because faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the evidence of things, what? Not seen. They crossed over and they were able to do so, but the Egyptians were drowned. And then we get to years, fast forward, the Hebrews 11, such a compressed account of so many years of history. Hebrews 11 tells about the time when they get outside the walls of Jericho. This is what they've marched for, toward. many of their ancestors, of course, all of them left behind except for Joshua and Caleb. And here now comes the moment. We're now ready to conquer the promised land and to conquer Jericho. We're waiting breathlessly for the military plan. What is it? All right, ready? What we're going to do is we're going to march around the city, all of us, once a day for 6 days. We're not going to say a word. And then on the seventh day, we're going to march around it 7 times. We're going to blow the trumpets and shout. Walls are going to fall flat, and we're going to go in and take care of business. What's plan B? There's no plan B. What relationship is there between marching around a city a certain number of times, blowing trumpets and shouting, and walls falling flat? Has that ever been done before? No, it hasn't been done before. So what makes you think? I'll tell you what makes me think. What God has done before gives me absolute confidence that if this is His plan, it will work. Mark it down. He's already given us the city. We just have to do what He asks. Now notice, if you will, if you drop down just for the sake of time, and boy, every preacher alive has felt the statement of verse 32. Time would fail me to tell. I wish I had more time to tell of Gideon. Oh yeah, Gideon, when's the last time 300 soldiers defeated thousands upon thousands and tens of thousands of Midianites? I don't know of a time. Samson, do you know of a time when this many Philistines have been defeated by one man with the jawbone of a donkey, and this many Philistines have been brought crashing down? Do you know of any time when, I'm not aware. David is mentioned in verse 32. David, tell me the last time someone with your lack of military training and your lack of life experience was able to go out and find a 9 foot, 9 inch tall giant, perhaps a very giant man named Goliath who's coated in body armor and he's well protected. When is the last time someone like you was able to do something like that? Do you know what David said? No, I've never fought a giant like this before. But I tell you what, I have the Lord delivered a lion and a bear into my hands. What God has done in the past gives me confidence of what He can do in the present, even if I've never seen it done. I trust God. And so there he goes out and fights Goliath. And then you'll notice verse 33. Stopped the mouths of lions. Daniel, how many people do you know of who have been thrown into a den of lions and lived to tell about it? Daniel, tell us. I don't know of any historical incidents where that's ever happened. You believe? I believe God's able. I don't know what He'll choose to do in my case, but I believe He's able. Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, also known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're Babylonian slave names. I think they probably prefer to be called by their Israelite names than the ones they were forced to wear in Babylonian captivity. But be that as it may, for identification purposes, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you're going to be cast into this furnace of fire if you don't bow before this image of Nebuchadnezzar. We can't bow. No. The Bible says not to. We won't. If you don't, you'll burn. Our God is able to deliver us. That boggles my mind. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, how do you know that God is able to deliver you from a furnace of fire this hot? Do you know of any historical incidents where anyone ever has been delivered from something like that? No. Can't say that I do. But I know the God of heaven and His resume. I trust God. If He wants to deliver us, it's no big deal for Him. And then you see the people inside Jerusalem, and you see the people outside, tens upon, really hundreds of thousands of Assyrian soldiers ready to do the same thing to Jerusalem they've done to 46 cities, 48 cities depending on the historical record that you're looking at prior to that, they're undefeated. Look at this, Assyrian powerhouse. They're undefeated. No one's ever brought them down. What makes you think you all are going to be the first ones to defeat us? Jerusalem, Judah, Hezekiah. I trust God. And so sure enough, the last part of verse number 34, turn to flight the armies of the aliens. 185,000 Assyrian soldiers didn't get up that morning. They were dead, not with arrows in them, but God had taken care of business. And there, the people that were left took off and ran for the hills, Sennacherib among them. And then people received their dead to life again. Others were tortured, not accepting deliverance. What made them so willing to not deny the Lord and not deny their God that they might obtain a better resurrection? Wait, how do you know you're going to be resurrected? I trust God. And that's why some of them were stoned. Perhaps Isaiah is the one under consideration when it says, we're sawn in half. The allegation is that Isaiah was sawn in half with a wooden saw. Now, 2020 hasn't been a picnic, has it? But I would say to you today that as I read Hebrews 11, I'm struck by the fact that what? God's faithful people have been through some things over the years. And yet what? Trusting in God, they have made it through. They have made it through. And you see, this is, as we start closing out here, the Bible talks about how the world wasn't worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and caves, verse 38 of the earth. They all obtained, or look at verse 37 and see if this matches your 2020. Slain with a sword, wandering about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, afflicted, tormented, as hard as things have been for us. And yes, there have been some trials, no doubt. And they're real trials for some more than others. The thing that encourages me to keep on keeping on, verse 40, God having provided some better thing for us, and then ignore the chapter division here because the original author didn't put one there to say, okay, I'm going to start a new chapter here. Wherefore, this points back to what we've just seen. We also are compassed about, surrounded with such a great cloud of witnesses. Let's lay aside every weight, the sin which does so easily beset us, and run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. One of my favorite Olympic moments of all moments was Derek Redmond. Derek Redmond, I can't even remember how many Olympics ago it was. He was a runner. He got injured during the race. He could barely walk, much less run. But he was determined to see that finish line. And his father actually came out of the stands. The way this worked was their last laps were to be made in the arena in front of cheering fans. Derek Redmond hobbled, was trying his best to make it around to see the finish line when suddenly a figure came out of the stands that he recognized. That's my father. And his father gave him someone to lean on and walk that last lap with him. And he crossed the finish line. I'm sure there were times he thought, I'll never finish this race. I'm so glad today to be able to say to you that in spite of things that may have happened in your life and in mine and the lives of others we know and love, people in our community. We serve a God who can do things providentially even through his divine will and providence that we might not think possible. Doesn't always require a miracle for God to do the things that he wants to do. We see providential examples in the life of Esther. Do you think things are going to turn out well for you and the Jews when this decree has been sent out that you're all going to be annihilated and it's irrevocable? You're going to be annihilated. No, God is, who knows what's going, God is going to deliver us. Mordecai believed in something that seemed impossible. And so I say for our purposes today, by way of encouragement, I can stand here and tell you with absolute certainty, whatever you're going through, whatever you've been through, whatever you're going to go through this year and in years to come, long after the word coronavirus is absent from our vocabulary, except as a past memory, there is a God in heaven. He's still there. He made this world. He loves you. He sent his son to die and bleed for you and for me so that you and I could have a better world. And he's still in charge. He's still on the throne. And we don't need to live in despair. We can trust in a God we've never seen to still be able to do things we've never seen. I thank you for your attention.